Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Dear friends in Christ, have you ever jumped into the middle of something? If you opened up a book, a novel, and started to read, you would be kind of confused. You would not know who the characters are. You would find it difficult to follow along. Or have you ever jumped into the middle of a conversation with someone? There's a group of people talking and you come into the group and it seems like they would just ignore you. You're not sure what they're saying. Or worse yet, Lord forbid, if you ever jump into the middle of an argument and there people are just heated and you're not sure exactly what side to take, and pretty soon you just want to step back. You don't want to jump into the middle of something. Sometimes when you jump into the middle of something, it can be confusing. It can be difficult to know. It can be a bit awkward. Last Sunday, we finished our 31-week-long series, The Story. We learned so much from that, from Genesis all the way through Revelation. We have a much better grasp of the Old Testament. We have a much better grasp of some of the teachings of the scriptures. We have a new understanding about God at work in our lives. And it's about God's story. But if you're like me, this week I was starting to feel some withdrawal pains. It had no books to read, no chapters to follow, nothing to catch up. We did not have to do our Bible class on the same topic today. We did not have a video this morning. There are no study questions or sharing questions to take home and to discuss with others. And so if you're like me, it's like, so withdraw me. What are we to do? What are we going to do in our worship services? Well, as a transition, we'll go back to our custom of following the church year calendar and the lectionary reading. The assigned readings for each Sunday. And we happen to be in the Gospel of Mark. And we are jumping into the middle of this book. This Gospel called Mark, right in the middle. Matter of fact, we're jumping into the middle of a chapter. And so it might be confusing for us. We're not sure what has been happening and where is it going. The Gospel of Mark was written by a man named Mark. The very same Mark that we heard about a few weeks ago. John, a cousin of Barnabas. Barnabas and John Mark and Paul had gone on the first missionary journey. And we had learned that for some reason, John Mark quit the team. He left the journey and went back home. We don't know the circumstances. Was he sick? Was someone at his home sick? Did he have to go back home for some important matter? We don't know the details. All we know is that during this missionary journey, this first missionary journey, this all-important journey of sharing the gospel and getting the message out, John Mark deserted the team. He left. When it came time for a second missionary journey, Barnabas, the encourager that he is, he wanted to bring John Mark along again. But Paul said, no way, not this time. And so they disagreed and they ended up going their separate ways. God multiplied the missionary teams and sent Barnabas with John Mark and Paul with Silas, and they continued to share the gospel and bring it to all the world. Later, toward the end of Paul's life, in his writings, he reminds us, bring John Mark to me, for he has been useful in my ministry. This young man who had deserted had somehow matured and been very influential and important in Paul's ministry. It's a story about redemption, how God still can use a person and utilize him in an important way. It's that John Mark now who writes this gospel called Mark. Some people call the Gospel of Mark the passionate gospel. Because when you read this gospel, it's very intense. It's very urgent. It's a strong message. It's a message that uses the word immediate many, many times. Immediately this happened, and immediately that happened. Immediately they did this and that. And so there's a sense of urgency, and it's a passionate message. In this gospel, you don't hear about angels or Joseph or Mary. No stable, no Bethlehem. Nothing about Jesus' birth. Nothing about Mary and Joseph or any of the genealogy or anything about the background. The very beginning of Mark chapter 1, verse 1 says, the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. It jumps right into the middle of Jesus' life. And what have we been missing so far? In chapter 1, we hear about Jesus' baptism, and then his temptation in the wilderness. And then chapter 2, about Jesus casting out evil spirits. Chapter 3, the calling of the disciples, the healing of the paralytic. And then chapter 4, Jesus begins to teach the parables. The parable of the sower, the parable of the growing seed, the parable of the mustard seed, right before our lesson. The parable of the mustard seed, how the smallest seed can grow into the largest plant. That's what faith is like. And as we look at this gospel lesson today, as we jump right into the middle of chapter 4, we find Jesus finishing teaching these parables. And now he's tired. And he says to his disciples, let's cross over to the other side. Jesus wanted to go over to the other side of the lake. They were at the Sea of Galilee, and now he wants to cross over. And the disciples took Jesus along. They left everything behind. They left the crowds behind. Perhaps they left their family and their friends behind. Perhaps they left some of their possessions behind. But the disciples left the crowds, and they took Jesus onto the boat to cross to the other side. And when you're reading this passage, it's really like the disciples were bringing Jesus along, like luggage, like an accessory. They're going to put Jesus on at the back. They'll put Jesus in their pocket, and they'll journey, they'll go. Do you ever do that in your life? Do you ever say, okay, I'm going to bring Jesus along with me? Almost like a good luck charm. I'm going to put him in my pocket. I'll bring Jesus along when I go shopping. I'll bring Jesus along on my vacation. As I journey here or there, I'll have Jesus. But it's more like an accessory. We bring him along. Sure. That's what the disciples would do. That's the sense of what the scripture says. And as they get onto that boat, they begin to cross the lake. And if you were on that Sea of Galilee, if you were looking out on the horizon, you would see the background. You would see Mount Hermon, a tall mountain. And what you would see at different times of the year would be snow-capped peaks. And there would be these strong winter winds that would just blow down into the lake. And when it mixes with that warm air, it would create these strong winds, and it would have these storms that come up out of nowhere, waves that were as high as 6 and 8 feet tall. And that's what happens. They're out on that boat, these disciples, four of whom are professional fishermen, four of whom made a living fishing on that very sea. They were experienced. They knew how to fish, they knew the sea, they knew the conditions. They had experienced all of these things before. They knew how to swim. They had no fear of the water. And yet when this storm came upon them, the waves began to batter the boat. And they were fearful. What kind of boat were they on? Most likely a fishing boat, being fishermen. A typical fishing boat was about 27, 28 feet long. And maybe about 7 feet wide. That's not much wider than this aisle I'm standing in. And the sides were very low, lower than the piers, because they were fishermen. They would take the nets and they would cast out the nets, and then they would bring in the fish. And so the sides were very low. And so when these winds and waves began to batter the boat, it was starting to fill the boat. And the disciples were fearful. They were afraid. These professional people were afraid that they were going to sink and perish and die. Can you imagine that? And so they cried out to Jesus, who was asleep in the back on a cushion. Lord, don't you care that we are perishing? Do you ever feel that way? Have you ever been caught in a storm? Some chaos in life, and you wonder, God, where are you? Jesus, why don't you do something? Why don't you work your magic? Why don't you work your power? Why don't you do something to help me out, to save me? Why don't you change that person, or change that situation, or change that circumstance? Have you ever experienced that in your life, where you're calling out to God and wondering, God, where are you? Jesus, why don't you do something? Why don't you come and help me? Perhaps you feel God is testing you. That He's putting you to the test, testing your faith to see if you are worthy. There was a captain on the boat. The boat was sinking. All the passengers had been put on life rafts and were safe. There were three crew members left, and one lifeboat left that could only accommodate three people. And so the captain told him, if you answer the question correctly, you can get on the lifeboat. So he asked the first sailor, name the ship that was supposed to be unsinkable, that traveled over the Atlantic. And he said, the Titanic. And he was right. So he was able to go on to the lifeboat. Then he said to the second man, how many people perished in that boat? And that second sailor said, 1,517. That's correct. You can get on the lifeboat. And then to the third sailor, vying for that last seat on the lifeboat, he says, now tell me the names of all 1,517 sailors. And of course, he could not answer that. So don't you feel that way sometimes? Don't you feel like when you are experiencing these storms in your life, the chaos in your life, that God is putting you to a test and He is asking you questions that you cannot answer? That He is putting you in a place where you feel insecure? That's not it at all. Jesus is present. He is allowing these storms in our life, the chaos to happen, for a reason. It is just as He was trying to teach the disciples with His very last parable, the parable of the mustard seed. It was about faith. A number of years ago, there was something called a biosphere 2. There's these scientists, they sequester themselves and they create these artificial environments. There was a rainforest, there was a desert, they even created an ocean. The only thing they could not recreate was wind. And after 2 years, the acacia trees that grew began to wither and some even snapped. Because there was no wind, the tree could not grow apart. The wood could not be strengthened because it had nothing for it to fight and lean against. That's why God allows these storms in our life, the chaos that sometimes happens, so that our faith might be strengthened, so that our character might be strengthened, so that we are strengthened in our daily walk and trust with Him. That's why God allows Him. It's not that He's not there, because Jesus is there. He is present. And He is always going to answer us whenever we call out to Him. The disciples said to Jesus, don't you care if we're perishing? Of course Jesus cares. He cares for you in much the same way, even greater. For Jesus has died for your sins. He wants to reclaim you as his very own. He desires to love you and to show his grace to you. He is present. He has promised, I will never leave you nor forsake you. He wants to grant you peace in your life. In the midst of that storm, the disciples are crying out. But Jesus says, peace, be still, and the waters will come. How does peace look in your life? An artist was asked by a wealthy man to paint a picture of peace. And so that artist goes back to the studio, he thinks about it, and he then says, this is what peace looks like. And he paints a painting, clear blue skies. He draws a painting of mountains and pastures, everything lush and green. And he brings that painting to the wealthy man, and the man says, that's not peace. Try again. So the artist goes back to his studio. He thinks, what is peace? And he says, it must be related to family. And so he paints a picture of a mother holding a newborn child. And they're both smiling at each other. And he brings that picture to the wealthy man, and the man says, that's not peace. So once again, the artist goes back to his studio. He's just depressed and disappointed, not sure how to paint peace. And so he begins to pray and asks God, show me what peace looks like. And God gave him the idea, and man begins to paint. And he paints on this canvas a beautiful picture. And he brings it to the wealthy man. And the man receives it and says, that is a picture of peace. What did that picture look like? It was dark, stormy, clouds, water and waves. But when you look in the background, there in a little niche, a little cleft in the mountainside, you saw a nest with a bird sitting there. Safe and protected, not worried about all that was happening around him. That's a picture of peace. That's what is happening for you. That is your peace, knowing that you are safe in the Lord, even while things around you are in chaos, even when there are storms that are coming at you, you can have that kind of peace in the Lord. When the disciples saw what Jesus did, they were afraid. They were even more afraid of Jesus than of the waves and wind. This says that they were fearful with the greatest fear. They were fearful because now they recognize, who is this Jesus? And they were discovered that he was the Lord of creation, that they were standing in the very presence of the Son of God, that he would be all-powerful and almighty, that he had even power over creation, over nature, over the wind and the waves, that this was the Son of Man who could cast out demons, the Son of Man who had power over all of nature. That was Jesus. But it would be a godly fear. Just like it says, the beginning of wisdom is the fear of the Lord. It's what we have also. We fear the Lord not because of judgment. We fear the Lord because he is so awesome, so powerful, that he is the one who has control of all things. We are fearful of the Lord in a healthy way, knowing that he is able to answer our every prayer, that he is in control over all circumstances. We have a healthy fear of the Lord because we trust in the one who loves us unconditionally. He is the one whom we learn all things, and these are the lessons that we learn from from the storm. Amen. Now may the peace of God, which passes all human understanding, guard safe your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen.